"And this was where history was made," said Sean, impersonating a documentary film narrator. "In this humble apartment building in the San Fernando Valley area of Los Angeles, few people realized what was stirring. That history, not just rock and roll history, but the overall history of history itself, was here being born." Hi, I'm Neal A. Yeager, and today I'm reading from my novel, Non-Hollywood. If you've been following this for a while, you know that this is a story of actors, filmmakers, and musicians. Now, I have a few other books whose characters are musicians. We've got The Next Seattle, which is about a group of musicians trying to pull together a music scene, and Political Music Club, which is about a group of musicians writing modern protest songs. But back to Non-Hollywood. This is Chapter 34, Four-Track Analog Recording. Sean was in the apartment of his waif-like neighbor, Icon. She had a rather impressive computer system, which featured a couple of gigantic monitors. She needed this computer power because she ran video editing programs so that she could edit films. Icon was hooking up an electronic box to her system. The box would allow for the transfer of analog audio to digital audio. "The key to it all," Sean continued narrating, "the perfect blending of past and present technology. The perfect marriage of the analog with the digital. The X15 with, whatever system she's using here." Icon, not the most talkative person in the world, simply smiled and continued hooking things up. She strung two cables from the little box and plugged them into the ancient piece of recording equipment, the Fostex X15. The X15 was what is known as a four-track recorder. Basically, four different musical parts could be recorded on the same cassette tape, thus four-track. At the time the recorder had made its debut in the 1980s, the standard for professional studios was giant 24-track tapes. So a portable recorder, which would allow musicians to accomplish recordings in their own homes at a reasonable price, was groundbreaking and cutting edge. Sean had been given the X15 when he was 12 by an uncle who had used it in his synth band during his college years. Though the world had turned to digital recording, which featured an essentially unlimited number of tracks, Sean continued with the X15. Mainly, it was that he couldn't afford all the computer equipment necessary for digital recording, but he also knew that a lot of older musicians preferred analog. Plus, he had a soft spot for the recorder, as it and a $5 silver tone guitar were what had started him on this musical journey nearly a decade ago. "Analog was the key," said Sean dramatically, bringing an end to his pretend documentary narration. "I love the X15. Have I told you that? I don't know how I'd live without it. There's just something about analog, you know? All the great music of all time was recorded on analog. Just ask, you know, Eric Clapton or Keith Richards, any of those guys. I mean, if you happen to, like, see them on the street or something. Analog is the only way to record. I love it." Icon replied, "Well, I shoot on film when I can. I love film." "Yeah, same sort of thing," said Sean as he looked around her apartment, taking in the various stacks of equipment cases and bags. "Oh, is that what all this equipment hanging around is? Film equipment?" "Mostly. I have a lot of digital too, but I love working on film." "I get it. I really do," said Sean. "But dude, I hope you have some insurance on this stuff. Living here, there's a bunch of thieves living in this building. Actually, I bet that one or two of them are living in my apartment." "I'll try to be careful with it." "Yeah, you should," he said. "Oh, and hey, thanks for all that you've done for me here. One day, when I hit it big, I'll take you out to dinner to say thanks. Or actually, by that time, I'll be famous, damn it. So I should just go ahead and buy you a Porsche or something like that. How's that?" "Dinner would be fine," she said softly. "Really? You don't want a Porsche? How could you not want a Porsche? They're beautiful, beautiful, absolutely beautiful cars." She said, "Well, they're just not for me." "Why? Because driving a Porsche makes you look like an arrogant douchebag?" "Something like that." That's the point, Sean smiled and said. Dude, you're supposed to look like an arrogant douchebag. You spend that much money on a car so that people look at you and say, wow, I wish I was that guy. What an arrogant douchebag. That's the whole point. Icon finished plugging in the X15 and went back to the computer to start her audio recording software. The two of them had been through this drill many times, so she knew what was required and where to set her input levels. She popped the cassette tape into the recorder and said, okay, we're ready. Alrighty, said Sean as he reached for the knobs of the X15. The knobs controlled the volume levels of each instrument and the pan, how much of each channel was heard on the left and right speakers. Sean would adjust these as they were digitized in order to come up with the perfect mix. He hit the play button, and after a few moments, a distorted guitar sound came booming out of Icon's speakers. This one's a cover, he shouted over the shredded guitar. Do you recognize it? Icon shook her head no. Sean smiled. Wait until the vocals kick in, then you will. And at that, he adjusted the knob which controlled the volume of the vocal track. A few moments later came his shouted vocals. The vocals he was shouting? Scarborough Fair. Sean pumped his fist in the air and shouted out a great woohoo! He looked over at Icon, whose face registered no recognition. He shouted to her, you don't know this song? She shook her head and he continued, really? Scarborough Fair? Simon and Garfunkel? Actually, they didn't write it. It's a song from way back in Hobbit times, but Simon and Garfunkel made it famous. You don't recognize it? No, sorry, she said. Oh, man. Well, here's the thing. It's about the last song in the world you'd expect to have distorted guitars. So I'm doing it with distorted guitars. The song played until the end. Then Sean hit the rewind button to take the tape back to the beginning of the song. I can't believe you don't know Scarborough Fair. How about Mrs. Robinson? No? Sounds of Silence? You have to know Sounds of Silence. It's like one of the best songs ever written. Either that or Red Rain. Icon merely shook her head. Okay, how about Paul Simon? Please tell me that you at least know who Paul Simon is. Yes, she replied. Thank God. So, what is that, Dolphin Chant, the only music you listen to? The Dolphin Mantra, she corrected him. Yeah, whatever. Remind me to give you a damned music education. How's this? I give you a music education, and you give me a film education. Deal. Great, said Sean. He looked at Icon and noticed that she was blushing, looking slightly downward and smiling in a way that seemed... Well, he wasn't sure. For a moment there, he almost thought that he had caught her checking him out. As in, you know, an attraction sort of checking him out. But he wasn't sure. And he still hadn't been able to figure out this girl. She still struck him as a little bit odd. Cute, but odd. Sean hit the play button on the X15 and started the song again. They would usually do several mixes of each song until they arrived at the one that they thought would work. As the song started playing, a thought seemed to occur to Sean, and he asked, where did Icon come from? I mean, I know what an icon is, but I've never heard of it as a name. Is that like Greek or something? Because you don't look Greek. Icon looked at him curiously. It's not my real name. It's what I call myself. Oh, I get it. That makes sense. I hate my real name, she said. What's your real name? Asked Sean. Icon refused to answer. She merely looked at the audio waveforms scrolling by on her computer screen. Okay, I guess I'll just have to go through your mail or something. And don't think I won't. Hell, the way they just stack extra stuff by the mailboxes, it's pretty easy. In fact, and as he was speaking, the X15 gave out a great screeching, grinding noise. Then a loud boom echoed out of the speakers, and the room was plunged into silence. Both Sean and Icon looked over at the ancient X15. It never played again.